Okay. Hi, everyone. My name is Eran Kinzbrunner. I work at Perfecto Mobile. I'm a mobile technical evangelist and working at the product management, product marketing team. I'm here with Andy from our system engineering team, sales engineering team. This topic today is about striving through the continuous deployment, continuous integration for mobile application quality, and how actually to do it right. A word about us, about Perfecto Mobile. Perfecto Mobile is the leader today in continuous quality. We offer a continuous quality lab, which means ability to our customers, giving ability to our customers to remotely access real devices, smartphone, tablets, smartwatches from anywhere in the world, real devices, and perform their continuous integration, development, testing activities, manual performance testing, and monitoring against these devices. We integrate with many of the leading test frameworks and continuous integration tools in the market, such as HP UFT, Selenium, Calabash, soon to come Appium, and we also have definitely integration with Jenkins. We have a plugin in the Jenkins wiki page. You can find it out. We have several partnerships with many of the leading technology players in the market, IBM, Microsoft, and so forth, and considered as market leaders by many of our research firms such as Gartner, Forrester, and others. What you're going to cover today in this short session is an overview about the mobile changes, what mobile does to this entire SDLC, software development lifecycle, and how we can actually address it. We are going to describe the CI challenges with mobile and actually how to overcome them. We have some best practices around that. And also share some of our examples working with some of our customers, enterprises, and other vendors in the market. So you can actually take some, working examples from the field. So when we talk to our customers and when we, working with the technology partners themselves, what we hear often is the need for speed, okay? There's always the tension between velocity and quality. How to actually release much faster to the market without compromising on quality. Today, especially in mobile, what we see is that there is a trade-off. Many organizations do a trade-off between these two very important aspects. And unfortunately, in today's world, you actually cannot do these trade-offs. You actually need to combine both quality and velocity. And we see the dynamics in the market. We see almost every 6 months a new platform operating system is being released. Every few weeks, we hear about a new smartphone, a new tablet, and so forth. And the content of each application delivery is definitely increasing. So we have a competitive landscape, competitive market. So every new mobile application which is out there wants to add an additional competitive feature. It wants to support the new smartwatches. It wants to add more capabilities and so forth. So in order to keep this velocity, but also quality, there needs to be a new mindset shift. And we're going to talk about these changes, challenges, and actually solutions in this session as well.
Okay, I'm going to take this one. One of our major customers in Europe is Rabobank. Now, they've been a customer for about a year now, and they've actually collaborated with us to actually share their experiences and their journey to agile and to continuous integration. It's a journey that's been a long journey for them. They've been doing it for 3-4 years now. And there's some statistics on here, the kind of thing that kind of triggered this whole journey that they're on right now. And I don't know if you can read the statistics there at the back of the room, but what you're seeing there from the desktop there, you've got like 3.6 million users registered. There are 18.6 million logins per month from those users, which is a lot. When you compare that with iOS, where there are a lot less, it's only 1.2 million users registered, they're logging in 30 million times a month. So you're seeing that the mobile digital channel is something that's driving a huge amount of work through their channels. So the importance of mobile, the importance of a quality mobile experience is absolutely key and critical to an organization like Rabobank. So what they've actually come up with, they needed to formulate the right strategy for how they're going to do the testing, to how to be agile. So what this graphic is basically telling you is how they approached, or, you know, if you like, the strategy for the strategy. That's what we're saying here. So at the top there, we've got the business facing. So in other words, what are the criteria by which we're being judged by our business sponsors and by our customers? And then at the back one there, we've got some overlap on the slide at the bottom, but the technology facing. So that's the internal stuff. It's saying, okay, I've got a user interface. It might be it's the mobile user interface, and that's actually talking to the mid-tier and the back-tier systems and services. And then the rest of it is about in terms of how they actually are going to grade the various factors that are involved in this. So we've got, that box has moved at the bottom. We've got the critical projects on the outside, and we've got, I'm not quite sure what that one is, for the programming on the left-hand side. So we've actually got, from the automated side of things, we've got the functional tests, you know, the systems integration that you've got, the portability testing. These are all key, important things. We've got the actual unit testing that you need to do. So, you know, do you want to do the unit testing on a small granular level or on a larger level? And then we've got the manual testing. So what's important to you? You know, one of the things that we can call out there is things like accessibility testing, which is quite a big deal in the United States, for example, Section 508, and in the UK, the Disability Discrimination Act. There's actually a compulsion on app vendors and mobile website vendors to be able to make sure that even that the disabled, visually impaired, and audio impaired users can actually use the apps and have a quality experience there also. Okay, pass back to Iran.
Thank you. Basically, what's the difference? Okay, so we look at desktop application, web application, and things are much more clear over there, right? We have this traditional unit testing, integration testing, we have UI testing. It's more or less doable, even talking about the velocity and quality conversation which we had just a few moments ago. However, when we look at the mobile experience, Andy talked about quality of experience, and we look at it also at quality of engagement, okay? When we look at the end user at the end of the day, this is just an example of a 90-minute commute of a typical end user in the mobile space. It's much more complicated, it's much more advanced than what we've been used to in the desktop, in the web environment. So it's doing a bunch of activities. Some of them are within the app context, some of them are outside of the app context. Events are probably coming in, is in different network environment conditions and so forth. So everything is part of this end user experience, end user engagement, if you like, and needs to be taken into account. So what does impact on you if you are the developer or you're the test automation manager and so forth? How does it impact your daily activities? So we talked about the mindset, the shifting. So we've seen the previous slide, the user profile, if you like. So when we look at the mobile space, so add on top of what we saw in the previous slide, mobile devices, mobile operating systems. We talked about the velocity, the changes in these areas. I've just made available, I think, a few weeks ago, something called the mobile test coverage, the mobile test coverage index. This is a report, a quarterly report, which gives our end user, it's a free report, by the way, which you can download, but it gives our customers, end users, whoever wants to download it, some kind of an insight, a filter of this complex, fragmented market space, mobile market space. Which devices are most popular in Europe, in US, in different regions? Which operating systems do you need to take into account, right? If you neglect a very important operating system, which many of the organizations are doing actually, it has definitely consequences. So we look at operating system versions, minor versions and big versions. We know today about iOS 8.4. I think that end of this month is the due date for this GA, for this 8.4 release. iOS 9 Beta 1 is already available in the market. Android 6.0 the name is still to be defined, is already available as well as a beta. So all of these changes in the market definitely requires a different mindset. We look at also CPU and memory. Okay, how is your application or your device coping with your mobile application when many other things are working parallel in different hardwares on your device, systems on chip, if you like. Okay, so everything here just adds on top of the complexities. And then we have this target environment. The target environment is, I've shown you in the previous slide, this environment, the user profile. So we have different network conditions, we have different locations, we have different notifications. And you talked about manual. I will take this to the exploratory phase, to the interoperability stage, where many pop-ups, events are coming in, phone calls, notifications from the watches to the watches, whatever. All of these things definitely comes also into play as part of your entire end-user environment, if you like. So these are definitely additional considerations which you need to take and implement as part of your strategy on top of this traditional UI integration and unit tests, okay? Events, loads, and so on are definitely part of this mix as well. So what is our working cookbook and the continuous feedback or this shift left of the feedback back to the developers, okay? So what we would like to offer, what we'd like to refer in this slide is that organization today, in order to cope with what we have covered so far, needs to align their QA tools to development, okay? Developers today need to have access to the devices themselves, to this end user environment from their working IDEs, okay? From their CI implementations. If they're working on different tools, QA are working on their tools, let's say, I don't know, a non-traditional developer environment, such as HP, UFT, and so forth, which, by the way, we support, but it's not a traditional development environment, okay? Then there is a gap, there is a disconnect in the workflow, in the CI process between these two teams. So at first, we are looking at alignment between QA tools and development environments, okay? If it all can tie and work as an orchestrated process from the same environment which automation engineers and developers operate in, it's definitely, it's not the best practice, it's actually the only way it can work to bring this velocity gap, actually to eliminate this velocity gap. Shared lab, okay? We know that different devices, different operating systems behave differently, so the sharing of resources, the collaborative environment where developers and testers, they might be in the same team, the agile team, okay, work against is definitely an imperative aspect in the entire workflow. Continuous integration, we are in this event just to talk about continuous integration, but continuous integration that works in an unattended fashion has its own price, has its own best practices, especially when we talk about mobile environment, okay? So how to make continuous integration work for mobile in an unattended fashion? There are requirements. You need to have an automation which works across platforms, run in parallel, knows how to address, we talked about the user profile, events coming in, right? You have incoming calls, incoming events. You need to be able, as part of your continuous integration test code execution, to be able to address all of these noises, if you like, but these are not noises, these are the actual environment which your end user lives in, okay? But this is part of your test environment, okay? So apply a real user condition, early non-functional. This is something which is being neglected, I think, for several years now, and I think that the market starts to realize that performance testing in mobile is not the same as performance testing in the web or desktop environments, okay? You don't have time in such a short iterations to apply performance only in the late stages of, you know, post-beta or, you know, when your mobile application stabilized, okay? You need to have performance testing hopefully as part of any CI, build acceptance testing or post-build acceptance testing just after that, you know, pass criteria. Otherwise, fixing this performance issue, especially in mobile, late in the game, takes a lot of time. definitely damages and puts risk to areas which you actually covered in regression and were stable in the past. So the earliest possible where you can start putting non-functional performance testing, usability testing into the mix, the better for you, okay? Automation is definitely one of the key aspects of CI, so it goes without saying. And the test frameworks, I think, goes into this alignment of QA tools and development. So this is like a cookbook, if you like. I think that all the keywords which you need to remember and put in your lab, if you like, are in these slides. And this what will give your developers this continuous feedback and will allow them to apply the iteration in a faster way. Unfortunately, because we are in this mobile space, which is dynamic, fragmented, and all of these negative approaches which it got over the last few years, there are CI blockers. There are continuous integration blockers. Some examples, starting to add real devices to the CI process, okay? We know that today there is there are Samsung S6, S6 Edge, LG G4 just came into market, Sony Xperia Z4, I can talk on new devices almost every day, right? So all of these new devices which comes into market seamlessly need to be applied and added to this continuous integration, okay? If you do not run a proper lab where you control the lab, you have all these charging capabilities, all these sophisticated environments and so forth, it's very hard for you to maintain and continue to adjust to this market dynamics, okay? You want to add new devices, new tablets, new platforms, and so forth. It needs to be seamless, okay? You need to have your environment built for these changes in the market, okay? A managed lab, device SLA, if you have someone which takes care of this lab for you, device as a service, what we used to call cloud, okay? This is something which is transparent for you. You take care of the development, you take care of the CI, let others handle these upgrades to devices, upgrades to operating systems, but you continue to run your process, you continue to increase your test coverage with new devices, new platforms, and so forth, in opposed to just starting with drivers and upgrades and so forth, which takes a lot of time and not always successful. A summary to the previous slide, if you have a lab that can provide you this SLA, okay, you pay for this, okay? You pay for a device as a service, you get an SLA, you get an assured service of device availability, platform availability, same day device availability, okay? If tomorrow the iPhone 6S, by the way, in September, a few months from now, a new iPhone 6S and new iPads are going to be launched in the market, a new Samsung Note 5 is going to be launched in the market, you want to have the same day availability, same day device availability for these devices, plugged into this CI process which already works for you, okay? You need a lab for that. You cannot manage it yourself. You will not stand in lines to get this new iPhone device like hundreds of thousands of people who are doing it almost on every new device launch, okay? Parallel execution is one of the most complicated things, especially in mobile, okay? And if you have just this laptop, which Andy is presenting on, try to imagine running two different, or let's say five different devices. One is Android, one is Windows Phone, one is a BlackBerry, from different operating systems, okay? Different manufacturers, drivers, and so forth. You have the limitation of a test framework. For example, UFT has issues running parallel tests on devices, right? So you need ALMs and you need other tricks so forth. So running test in parallel is also something which you want to require from this lab which you are building, okay? And the resource abstraction, of course, is something which is important, but we'll not touch it in this point. So let's just give one, we talked about best practices, let's drill down into a real life best practice example of selecting devices. Andy, you want to take this one?
Yeah, I'll just do that very quickly. I mean, just following on from the point that Aaron's just made about new devices being added into a cloud, what you can see here, for those of you that can read the code, is the fact that you can select, you've got Selenium capabilities. I'm presuming most people in the room know what they are. So you can select a device based upon a capability rather than an absolute device ID. So the beauty of this is that, you know, you select, for example, any Android device or any Android device that's in the UK or any iOS device which is in Boston, Massachusetts or whatever. This is essentially what we're doing here. It's like data-driven testing. So as you fold these new devices that you've acquired into your lab, you don't need to change your scripts. They're actually going to naturally become part of the life cycle of your apps and your mobile websites and the actual evolution of your data center with the devices in them.
Right, Andy. And just going back to the point about device coverage and so forth, you don't need to worry. If you have this capability, okay, so it's agnostic to you. You say, okay, I want to test my, here it's the Starbucks application on any Android device running Android, let's say Android 5.0 or 5.x, okay? You just put it in the code, in your test code, in the same way you do it for iOS, in the location, which is Canada. Putting these targets, filtering this device and operating systems and other environment capabilities, mixing all of them, actually gives you what we talked about a few slides earlier, this end-user environment. This guy can be traveling, can be in different location, different devices, different operating system. You run this with the select device, select parameters. This is in Selenium from the Eclipse environment. We talked about IDEs, developers, testers running from the same environment, collaborative environment. Having this capability for your developers definitely is the pain. And it's agnostic to a device. It's agnostic to anything. You just put the filters as you like from your priorities perspective, and you get this test done either as a service or as part of your continuous integration cycles. Any questions so far? By the way, feel free to interrupt. Something is unclear. Few more examples of CI blockers, of continuous integration blockers, from what we are running into every day. Developing UI automation takes too long, okay? When you're looking at testing the UI, especially in mobile, okay, it can be painful. We can think about several examples. From one, different platforms results in different user experience. Sometimes the developers themselves implement the user interface on an Android in one way on than the UI on an iOS device. Okay, so from a testing perspective, this is becoming a challenge. Okay, you need to have your testing run across platforms. So this is one of the CI blockers. It takes time. Okay, you want a short iteration. You need to have ability to test across platforms when the UI is changing. The maintenance, this is not, it's nothing new. It's automation maintenance is a pain in not only in mobile, but for everyone. But if you develop it smart, and if you treat the automation test code as part of your test project, your entire project, you can definitely ease the maintenance of it. How you actually, you know, resolve and overcome such CI blockers? Easy object identification. In mobile, we in Perfecto Mobile will look at it as the hybrid object approach, combining visual objects and OS level objects. Okay, not always easy to get access to these OS level objects, but it's imperative to actually get access to these OS level object properties and complement this testing with visual analysis of some of the screens, some of the objects, which might change across platforms, across devices, across screen resolutions, when you rotate the device and so forth. So easy object identification, the freedom to choose which object type, object analysis you are using as part of your testing is one way to overcome this pain which we've mentioned earlier. Reuse predefined code functions, okay? Mobile, when you release your mobile application and you test it once, it's not a one-time effort, okay? You do it one, you have, even if you don't have a new version, you have to test it for a new platform, a new device, okay? So you need to have everything maintainable, reusable, where you can just fine-tune specific things, but you need to make them, you know, changeable as only to the relevant or to the generic pieces, okay? Eliminate the cross platform differences and put the core or the generic aspects of your application in one place where you can actually leverage them across platforms. Right, cross-platform test code is definitely combined to what I've just mentioned. So here we have an example, Andy, about collaboration of test-friendly code. So we want to take this one?
Yeah. I mean, basically what we're saying here, I mean, anybody who's worked in a Scrum team will know that it's about multiple functions within one team. It's about communication. So what's really important is to make sure in your test cases that you've actually got a meaningful test case rather than a tester that's writing some code thinking, oh, it'd be quite cool to test that and knocking out some code that does that. So basically think about what the test case is. So who's the user, the person defining the actual test case, what's the journey through the app, what's the journey through the website. So this is where we have that little piece of cucumber script there on the left-hand side. So they're defining what the case is, what the test case is that's actually being tested here. And then gradually we're actually fleshing out, we're building up a bit of a data dictionary in the middle to be able to write the actual test. And then there's the coder at the end who's actually codifying that particular test. But it's actually a two-way street. This is about Scrum, this is about Agile. It's entirely possible that when the tester comes along to do the test, that actually there's something, maybe an object on the screen that's not being accounted for, something that's not being exercised, that needs to be exercised. And this is where you get together as a Scrum team and you talk about it. Far better than email, let's get together and talk. And then we can actually feed this back into the whole user case to make sure that what you're actually testing from a holistic viewpoint is exactly what should be tested to get, I say, the best quality app to the door at the end of the day.
Right, and by the way, we see today in Perfect Mobile a growing trend of BDD, behavior-driven development approach, becoming, you know, widely adopted just to bridge the gap between developers and testers, easing these test scenarios, test cases, as part of the development lifecycle. Okay, from the first moment when you know how the feature is going to work, you design the script, you design the feature, you design the tests themselves, and you test them during development activities. This is like a modern agile practice which we see today, especially in mobile.
Okay, so what we come on here, basically, just this is a very quick example of how you can code to run scripts cross-platform. So, I mean, for those of you that recognize the code, we've got in there some XPath, but we're basically saying, okay, it doesn't matter where on the screen a particular field is, if you code things correctly, you can actually run it. Say, you can see in the example here, an iPhone and an Android device. You know, through the platform, we enable something we call script once, which enables you to run the same automation test scripts across many different device platforms. And this is one of the ways in which you get the reusability, if you like, the resilience of the scripts automation that you've got in there, so that you can actually get the best bang for your buck out of those test scripts. Okay.
Okay, so the CI blockers, we talked about several types of CI blockers. This is another segment of continuous integration blockers, especially around the execution. And here you see that almost more than 25% of the execution failures and errors are due to unexpected notification, environment readiness, and device errors. What does it mean in mobile? Okay, I think that we talked about working within the application context and outside of the application context. We talked about the end user environment, the user profile, okay? When you develop your test code, your test automation, and you're just application agnostic, you're just, even if you're doing it across platforms, but you're just testing within the application, okay? This is, you know, one step towards failure, okay? Especially with regards to execution, test execution, automation, because mobile has a lot of surprises for us. We talked about notification, we talked about incoming events. By the way, even if you are not, if you are expecting them, or if you are not expecting them, this is what you need to test for, okay? I would say you need to actually plug these interrupts as part of your test code automation, as part of your test coverage, okay? You don't need to just try to avoid them or try to control them. You need to actually plan for them. And if there are unexpected notification, maybe in the first iteration it will fail, but the way you have to the way that you can control the device system, okay, and manage this notification, these pop-ups, security events, and so forth, gives you the ability to overcome and make your test code or the automation much more robust. If you can separate the test code and the execution management one from each other, this is one way to overcome what we've just mentioned. Okay. Another way to overcome that is to perform pre-test readiness checks in, you know, like a synthetic environment. Okay. Even in your own local environment, but then you populate it across more devices, you are more safe, okay? It's very straightforward. Add error and event handling. When you have system-level control, you can plug within your test code these pop-ups. You can look for pop-ups as part of your checks, okay? With the loops, if this pop-up appears, you'll eliminate it, you will click on it. Otherwise, you'll ignore and continue to the next phase and so forth, but it will definitely not require you to have an attended test automation, which is one of the most common CI blockers which we come across in the market. The way that you run the automation and you need to have some manual resource pressing for you on buttons or come in the morning and find that something fails because of whatever, this is one of the worst scenarios for you to move forward or to adjust to the mobile dynamics. So these are just a few more examples of CI blockers and actually how to avoid them from what we see in the market today.
So this is another code example. It might seem fairly obvious to you, but you know, it's bad enough that there are, if you like, things outside of your control that can actually cause test failures. So things in the environment that are completely unpredictable. So they're bad enough, but it's actually unforgivable to actually incur a test failure that's avoidable. And that's the kind of thing where maybe the previous test has failed, but you've not handled it correctly. Maybe you've not cleanly exited from the app when something's failed, because a lot of apps remember their context, they remember where they are. So and a lot of the automation scripts come in and assume they're starting from the beginning. So you need to be able to capture the errors as they occur, make sure it's, as it says in the word there, make sure it's graceful, and make sure that you've actually coded for failure as well as for success. And then that means when the next test comes along, anything that's avoidable, and it's like the human error part of it, let's avoid that, let's kind of get ahead of the game. So it makes a great deal of sense to make sure that you capture as much as you can do so that the next test is successful, okay? So that's all we're really trying to say here.
Just one more comment on that slide, Andy. I think that especially with CI, especially with test automation on mobile, having a baseline for your mobile device before you start the test and after you end the test is very critical to the next iteration, the next cycle, or even the next test scenario. Okay, going back to the home screen after finishing a test area, covering a test area, rebooting the device, like we see here, device reboot, at the end of the entire test execution, cleans the memory, cleans many things which were gathered on this device. I don't know, who knows how much time it was alive before you started testing on it, right? So getting some baselines before you start the test and after you close the test gives you some kind of a controlled environment and eliminates these errors which we see, especially in mobile. So just as a side note. Talked about velocity, talked about quality. Testing takes time, okay? And usually you do not have this time, especially in mobile, because you have a scale, you have many devices to cover, many operating systems, many test cases, many test scenarios. Here we are talking about UI automated test execution that exceed the available test window. Test window can be hours, we will soon see what it means. It can be hours, can be days, can be over the weekend, okay? So the planning here of the content, what you put in each test execution cycle as part of your build acceptance testing or the stage where you are is crucial to this to the CI success, okay? To the execution flow success. So we are talking about apply automation best practices here, doing tests in parallel, sync mechanisms, and so forth. You can contact us and see some additional, not only just snippets, but we can give you more real life examples of how we are accompanying our customers today to, put test iteration into sprints where we know how many devices can fit, how many test cases can fit in each iteration, and so forth. So we have this information available as well. You know, by the way, I didn't mention we have a community, a live community. You can also feel free to join and leverage some of the best practices in real time, community.perfectumobile.com. You can see many, many code snippets, many, many discussions over there. I'm sure that also this presentation will eventually be uploaded over there, so feel free to join. Talking about parallel execution, you can see here platforms and so forth, code example showing that. But I think that it's clear to you that if you have this lab, this device as a service, and you have a system, a test framework which supports the ability to run tests in parallel as part of your, you know, any stage where you are, even if you are in the unit test stage, or if you are in the build acceptance test, or if you are progressing toward functional testing and regression, this is a critical capability in mobile. And if you can plug it into the CI process, then it's a win, a great win for you. Let me move to this slide because I think that this is, we talked about coverage, about scope, and here is some of the best practices which we gathered from real customers, from you know, real projects running these days. And by the way, it doesn't matter if it's a native application, hybrid application, this is common to any mobile application. You can see here how this table is built, okay? We have the build frequency, whether you're doing a build on an hourly basis, on a you know, few times a day, nightly, or you're doing over the weekend this build and acceptance testing of this build, okay? Any of these frequencies has its own implications of how many tests you can pull into this cycle and on how many devices you can actually run this test on, okay? What you can see here is the breakdown, and you can take just an example of, take the good scenario when you have, let's say, up to 48 hours available for you to do testing of your build, okay, over the weekend. Look at how many things you can accomplish if you have a CI and automation, unattended automation that works for you. You can actually put, from test score perspective, you can put all of your unit testing, your system test, smoke test. Actually, you can put some of the performance testing, even if not all of our customers and enterprises, even mature, the more mature they will be, are not implementing that correctly today, but you can put almost the entire set of test methodologies into the CI process just over the weekend, and look at how many devices you can actually cover just over the weekend with a CI process that works for you. Almost 20 devices, okay? We talked about parallel execution, we talked about cross-platform testing, automation that works unattended, all of these pitfalls, controlling the system, controlling the pop-ups and everything, eliminating all the noise, the CI blockers. This is where it brings you, okay? When you just focus on the testing, you eliminate all the blockers, you use all these techniques of different object types, object recognitions. This allows you to put into one weekend a test automation test cycle of almost 20 devices. And you know, this is a significant amount of coverage for you to start the week with a level of confidence or not, depending on the results, but at least you get results and a very deep one across the different types of aspect of your mobile application. So this is, if you want to take something out of this session, remember this slide and think about what can come in the way of achieving the best of this you know, velocity. Okay? So with that, let's summarize some of the recommendation. Okay? Some of the recommendation which we have for you today are automation that requires an available lab. We talked about device as a service, lab that is available for you, takes care of, you know, all of these device frequency changes, operating systems, pop-ups, and so on. This is one thing. Maintain test code guidelines. We showed you some example of test code guidelines, how to maintain, how to develop this business logic across platforms, the changes which are behind each implementation, different UI changes and so forth. This is the second thing. Error and event handling, especially in mobile, okay? In mobile, you need to have full control of the device, of the application, of the environment, okay? Let's not forget about the environment, the end user at the end of the day, which travels, which has different network condition in different location and so forth. Take this into account as well. Framework maintenance, okay? The less you deal with maintaining the framework, if you build it right from the beginning, you just need to take care of the gaps, okay? Closing the gaps in functionality, minor changes in the test code, adding just few glitches, few devices and so forth, but it's much more easier for you to keep running your test in a reliable way. If you just spend most of your iteration, your sprint, in maintaining and, you know, operating your test environment, if you like, you're wasting your time. You cannot achieve this CI process as we showed in the previous slide. Readiness checks. I think that we talked about bringing your device, your test code, your test environment always into a ready state, okay? It can be from a test perspective, starting with a specific anchor, closing the device at the end, going back and so forth, okay? Having a controlled loop where you know when you start, if something breaks, you know where it breaks, okay? You don't always start in a different location. You have everything in an organized way, okay? It's good for testing not only in mobile, in general. This is the best practice in general. Optimize your execution, multi-threaded execution. These are more advanced types of recommendation for you, for the developers, for the test automation engineers, okay, for the architects, test architects, need to look and examine as the application evolves, okay? You need to stay ahead of this this curve, okay? You develop your test call automation, you have a CI that works for you, you always need to maintain it in a way that, okay, if something changes, if you want to optimize things, okay, something changes and you want to add a much more sophisticated aspect to your test code, synchronization things and so forth, you always need to have someone, it can be the architect of your, the test architect, it can be the developer lead and so forth, but you need to have someone looking at the architecture and always looking at it can always be optimized, okay? This is not a bulletproof solution. You always need to optimize, okay? So these are just some guidelines with the best practices which we are seeing today in the market. And I think that we are approaching the end of our time here. So just one important thing, okay? Cultural mentors, right, Andy?
Yeah, I mean, some of you will have been on a journey to become agile, and some of you might not have even started that journey yet. And there's a lot of people who sat there maybe thinking, okay, nothing's broken, why should we try and fix it? No two organisations' cultures are the same. So the point is, it's just a very quick reminder at the end of the presentation. You can talk technology, you can talk process till you're blue in the face. You actually have to recognise the different cultures within which you work to make sure you can find the best way to actually get the best out of what you're doing. Essentially, let's think about the people. It's that classic people, process, technology. You know, we start with people because people are most important. So just a quick reminder there at the end.
Totally agree. So with that, everyone, we are open for questions. I really hope that we brought some value to you and some best practices and examples. Any questions from you on this topic or any other CI-related mobile topic? Yes, please.
Right, okay. So the question is, like, this is in the notes you've got there, that Rabobank do 10 releases, or they're aiming to do 10 releases per day. So that's not full app releases. It's different levels of granularity. So it might be one component that makes up the app, for example. You know, you can talk about the likes of Amazon, who I think are doing, is it 40 releases a day? And eBay do even more than that. I've heard a figure of 300 a day for eBay. So these are obviously not full-blown whole platform releases. Clearly, that would be massive and unmanageable. So what we're talking about here are different releases of different levels of granularity. Okay, we're bang on time. Thanks for your time, everybody.
Thank you very much.